We have Roy here with us. He's the founder of Inside Out Studio.
It was always about signing the quotation, signing quotation. Nothing to do with the design, about what we wanted.
They thought black harder to dirty. Turns out they need to clean more.
The main part of the cost comes from the flooring, overlaying the toilet, and also...
Good evening, Singapore. Welcome to today's episode. So we've gotten quite a lot of positive feedback on a previous video that we did about the interior design industry, and we thought it's time for a part two. So today we're going to talk about common renovation mistakes that Singaporeans make
and how to avoid them.
That's the most important part, honestly, how to avoid them. So today we have Roy here with us. He's the founder of Inside Out Studio. Woo. And he has very kindly agreed to join us to share his expertise and experience because, as you know, none of us are in the industry. Roy, tell us a bit about yourself.
Hi guys, I'm Roy. I'm a founder of Inside Out Studio. I'm in this industry for 10 years.
But you look very young. How is it that you're doing for 10 years?
34.
So you started when you were 24.
What made you decide that this is the thing I want to do for the rest of my life?
Okay, so it's not easy because a lot is quite stressful. There are a lot of things need to handle, be it technical, numbers, design. There are a lot of aspects we need to master it. No doubt that I wanted to give up many times. Somehow or other, I managed to pull through.
So how long has it been since you started Inside Out?
Since COVID time, 2020. So it has been 4 years.
Wow, took matters in your own hands. Yeah.
I can't tell whether that's a good time or a bad time to start.
In fact, it was a good year because during that time, a lot of people told me, you know, don't start during COVID. But then surprisingly, it turned out so well because throughout these 10 years, I think that period was one of the good time.
So it was right after COVID.
After
measures
COVID.
Start to ease, and then that's when your company started.
Exactly.
So people were just getting their keys and all the backlog and everything.
Correct.
Then you have moved into your new house for about 6 months now.
Yes.
Actually, you are neighbors.
It's so strange. When he first came, like I came to the studio, he said, "Hey, hi neighbor." Now, like I confused. I thought we're sitting next to each other. Yeah. But yeah, you're moving into my block soon.
Has there been any regrets so far now that you've lived in your house for 6 months?
Have, but got positive, got negative.
Yep.
Okay. Not a lot. I just list
I'm
down.
I'm not here for the PC answer. And of course, I mean, like Roy, if you know of any stories from renovation regrets from your clients, right, you can share with us. Also.
Okay, so I think there's one common regret which I faced over the 10 years, which is the tiles.
Oh?
A lot of them complain
floor
to-
Floor tiles.
Floor tiles.
Oh.
They complain to me about the floor tiles. When we bring owners to go and shop for tiles, right?
Yeah.
That one store
all
that everyone
the floor
goes to.
Tiles is actually placed on this manner.
Yeah. On the wall?
Yes. Up vertical.
Vertical. So the actual fact is actually supposed to place it horizontal.
Flat ma.
Flat.
Why? So, to see the light.
I think they want to save space. But the actual fact that, you know, the lighting on the wall and the lighting on the floor is two different lightings.
Very different.
So that's one thing. Second, the texture and the roughness, it plays a part also. Because I have owner complained to me that it was so rough that they couldn't mop the floor.
Yeah.
But then, you know, when you buy tiles, there's a small note at the top left or top right corner. It says the roughness. R9, R10, R11.
Wow.
That determines the roughness.
Oh.
11 is the maximum. So at that point of time, I remember we chose R9. So yeah, it's not too rough. But somehow, I still got owner regret telling me that, she regret buying that tiles.
Wait, so is that R1? Like it starts from R1?
From what I know,
that's like marble.
From what I know, it should range from R9 to R11.
R9 is already the lowest.
Correct. And we can't do anything, to be honest. Sadly, we can't do anything.
Right?
Yes, and we lay.
Yeah.
But homeowner will say, why don't we advise from the start? Like I say, the tiles were placed on the wall. And because we often use our hand to go and feel it.
Yeah.
But the actual fact that we are supposed to use our feet to walk it.
So actually the towel shop right should
And I should bring a mop.
Yes. I must preface right by saying that Ned and I are very happy with everything. So like I think a lot of it is nitpicking. It's like things that like I suddenly wake up and go like, oh yeah. Oh. I think the first, it's not actually renovation related, but it's home related. Wish we got a 5-room instead of a 4-room. Mm. Every time I pass by my neighbor's houses, right, I'm surrounded. We are the only 4-room surrounded by 5 rooms. So every time they leave their door open, right, then I go like, so nice. Wow, got balcony, I better not say that. But like, it's like, wow, regret. But anyway, cannot do anything about maybe in 5 years time. The tiles one, right, I think we have two routes of regret because the first is that maybe we should have just spent more and gotten the larger tiles. Larger format tiles because we wanted to save a bit. And so we got like a medium sized one. And now every time I look at the grout lines, right, I'm like, cringe. Mm. The reason is because Nan and I wanted cement screed at first. Cement screed is like exposed cement. You know, it's like
our floor like, outside.
A bit like, you know, you go similar to Bali cafes, right?
Ah, okay, okay.
Then got like the, oh, yeah, like very raw. You know, the feel, that's cement screen.
I also like,
but we were told by every, so we met like 5 or 6 IDs. All of them said, don't do it because the ground will move and so there will be cracks that you cannot fix. Yep. Also, you spill wine or anything, right, it will absorb the color.
Absorb?
It's porous.
Yeah. It's porous. Whoa. So porous. What we did in the end was to try and find the next best alternative that could mimic the style that we wanted. So we went with like dark gray tiles.
Yep.
Okay.
But the dark gray tiles that we ended up going for because we wanted to save a bit of money, right? Correct me if I'm wrong, but the larger format, even though they're not necessarily more expensive per square foot, but because it's bigger, the manpower cost is
correct,
more.
The labor cost.
Yeah, the labor cost, because they have to cut more.
Heavier.
Exactly.
The foundation and everything.
But now looking at the ground lines, I wish that we maybe went for larger format or gone the completely other extreme and save and gone for vinyl instead.
Yeah.
But I see a lot of TikTok saying like vinyls, like they are bad vinyls.
Yeah.
Like over time, right, it will like flip up.
Yeah, you will expand, because of the weather.
Oh.
Contract and expand. So over time, the vinyl will pop out also.
Yeah.
And because vinyl is the thing that we just lay on top.
Like paste.
So the foundation of the surface is very important. If let's say the foundation of the surface is not even, then when you step on it, you can actually feel there's a dam.
Oh.
Then you become hollow.
In my old house, I think we had vinyl ones, right? And then our water feature, we had like a little fountain. We didn't know overnight that it flooded actually. Then the next morning, like everything all like
like a water bubble.
Like rubber. Like it all started peeling. So.
But easier to change, like, I guess. Like you just.
I can relate to this because this client of mine, 5 years ago, I did his house, and I think last 2 months ago, he contacted me. He said his vinyl were all, like what he mentioned, very wobbly.
Mm-hmm.
The water managed to seep all under and all start to expand.
Oh.
So it was a very serious thing. So we went down to assess the situation and then realized that it caused by the water. You know, the water seepage from the window.
From the window?
Oh.
Then how in that case? Because it's
so
not your fault.
For their case, town council settled this issue because the seepage is coming from the outside, the external of the building.
Yeah.
It's not inside. We had to remove all the vinyl. Then now we are still in the midst of doing it to replace the vinyl.
And town council pays for this?
For external part, yes. But internal, rightfully, I feel that they should. Lah, but then somehow they push.
Shout out this town council. Election coming, maybe they'll pay.
Yeah, quite poor thing. Yeah.
Okay. Because I have heard of cases where like sometimes it is the building's fault, right? And then like the carpentry, the cabinetry, all like rubber and GG, right? Oh. And today I say GG, I don't know why.
You play games this again.
Then I think the town council reimburse for the rebuilding.
Right.
But it really depends. Or like sometimes your upstairs neighbor leak, right? Then they have to pay for your new cabinets and all.
The pattern of the tiles is something that I've heard people complain because like you said, right, when you go tile shopping, you pretty much just see one piece. If not, they have like a small square maybe.
Yeah.
But when you lay out across the floor, then actually they hit the pattern.
Yep.
I would say this for what you call it, like the cabinet, it's not vinyl, laminates.
The laminates.
We almost had a regret, but thankfully John came in and said, hey, look, I think you should go and see it like in LUT format because we were looking at it from the book, right? And then we picked one laminate already. And it turns out that had it been done right, it would have been full of veins.
Correct.
So you mean you can ask to, as in,
you can go to the store. You can go to the store and then like pull out and then actually see what the LUT format will look like.
Right.
And then thankfully because of that, we actually changed our laminate to something else that we love now.
For laminate, you're possible to do that. For tiles, I think that's a big issue also. Because when we go to the showroom, we only maximum, we get to see 1 or 2 pieces only.
Oh, that's true.
Right. So by the time we lay, it's too late. But then somehow they have disclaimer. They put at the left side of the tile saying that veins and pattern variation. Mm. So so don't expect all the tiles to be the same.
Oh, this one like make my ID look good. cutting too many things to save money that my ID recommended. It's like a backhanded.
So your ID helped you save money?
No, so my ID actually said we should do this, but then Ned and I were trying to like cut costs, so then we said don't want this one.
Yeah.
Then now I like regret. So for example, he wanted to do like a false wall behind our bed so that we can create a niche, which will look very nice. It felt very extravagant and nothing necessary. So then I straight away take that out. We saved like, I don't know, 1,000, 2,000 bucks. But then now, right, that we didn't opt for our TV, we opt for a projector. I wish that we could have just put a projector like right above our bed
and a niche
would have just fit that perfectly. And then there's so many display stuff. So like Ned has a lot of like pop marts and I got a lot of like my Funko Pops, right? And then that would have been a really nice place to like display stuff. Mm. So I guess that's like one area. Mm. Not putting enough plug points, which I already felt like we purposely went for like a lot already. Like we purposely said, yeah, everywhere that we wanted one, we said put two. Mm. I forgot one place to put more than one, which was my bedside table.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. So then I had to go and get like an extension plug. Mm. And then like add, but really.
But I thought your Wusa bed got the plug.
Have. And actually that really saved like our, not save our lives, like, let's not be dramatic, but it really saved like the regret, the yeah. feeling, the negative feelings dissipated fast because of the Wusa bed. So like because of that, we have four USBs and two USB-Cs. Yeah. For charging, which is great. But then like we have the bedside lamp, got the projector, got all these different things. So like just wish that we had put more plug points.
So on the note of scrimping on things we shouldn't, I actually found an article on Qanvast, which I was surprised by because I thought Qanvast is an ID matching platform, but because we're working with them, right? So then I realized that they actually do way more than that. You can actually go on to find, their designers' portfolios are mostly uploaded as well. So you can see that there. And they also have like articles that help you along with your ID journey. Mm. So one of the articles that I found is 9 avoidable renovation mistakes that new homeowners make.
Oh, yes. Okay. So I feel like I would have stumbled upon this while doing my ID.
Yes. One of the points they did talk about scrimping on important components. So there are certain points where we feel like, this is extravagant and we take that out. And there are certain points where we splurge, but honestly, it's for nothing.
Very good. Yeah.
So where should a homeowner spend and save when they're thinking about renovating their house?
I feel that homeowners should spend on an essential built-ins. For example, kitchen cabinet, and wardrobe, because kitchen cabinet you can actually customize to the size of the kitchen, right? And of course the sink and the stove. And as for wardrobes, if example you buy from off the shelf, not only you collect you store your clothes, but also you store collect dust, because the cabinet you buy, let's say you buy from off the shelf, it doesn't go all the way to full height. So at the top of the cabinet you will collect dust. So I feel these two components is a must to build in, whereas the rest of the house it should be buy from off the
loose
furniture.
So like my TV cabinet, is it?
Yes.
Okay.
But it depends on the concept of the theme and the concept of the house also.
Yeah.
But my advice is try not to build in too many things, especially in the living room.
Oh.
Because first impression counts. So when guests come in, the living room should look spacious.
That's fair enough.
That is true.
And also because like your life changes also, like you suddenly have kids, you like increase the size of your household, you suddenly want more space. The living room is probably the first place that you want to like, kind of like shift things around.
Yeah.
So like, yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Oh, there's another common regret I see on TikTok and like YouTube. It's like, I didn't know that it would be a issue a lot of people think. It's a shower screen. Like, you know, in the toilet, there's like a separation, then the glass. Then it seems like a good idea, because if you bathe and then you don't want the water to get into the other areas. But then a lot of people say it's very hard to clean.
Yep.
So I feel like now the style is like people opt for either like those red glass, so you can't really see the, like, you know, the soap marks or the water marks, or they make a wall, half wall instead tiles, or they just like completely remove.
No, but the thing is that you completely remove, right, your whole toilet becomes wet.
But not like you gonna bathe like, woo, like that one.
You'd be surprised.
Okay. So we also asked the contractor for this solution, because a lot of homeowners feedback say why there are so much stain on the glass. So these are all the shampoo residue, the reaction stain on the glass. So by right, whenever you shower finish, you need to clean it immediately. This is how you maintain, which is quite tiring.
You can get the squiggly thing,
the squeegee.
The squeegee.
But it's very tiring. Not only you want to shower yourself, you also need to shower your glass. Right.
But that's still a
you need to double the time for your bath.
Please take note, the fluted glass, you mentioned the ripped glass, is actually not advisable because it's not fluted. It's not tempered.
So
when it shattered down, right?
It's really dangerous.
I decided to like opt out.
Because
now they're building my bathroom, right? Then I was like, thinking, because we initially wanted a screen. I hate it, right, when the toilet bowl is wet. I don't like the feeling.
Exactly.
But then like I think about cleaning the glass, because my car, like last time my house, the glass, right, is like damn moldy at the side, the corner. I really don't like it. It looks like damn dirty. Then how much I clean, right, it will kinda the lines again. So I decided to opt out from the glass.
I realized, I think the hack is vinegar and baking soda, Because like, okay, my biggest thing is that we do clean the glass. Yeah. It's just that it depends how you clean it. Because you use cloth, you can see the streaks. I hate the streaks.
Yes.
So then you got to figure out the best way. Like I think it's like sponge with vinegar or something. Yeah. And like
that's what my dad does. But then the whole toilet
smells like vinegar.
For like a good day.
Better than a wet toilet bowl though. Trade off.
Depends on what you want. No, but also like because you just got your house, so I feel like when people just get their house, they feel like I'm a homeowner, and then every single thing must be spick and span, right? But you wait for like 2 years, you won't do it.
Yeah, then you curse like the vinegar.
It does help that we just got a helper. So I guess like, that's why like I'm okay now. Yeah. I'm happy now.
Another thing that homeowners regret is blindly following design trends. Mm. So one good example is nowadays, right, everything in the toilet, right, people like to put black color. So like my tap is black color. Then some people even make their toilet bowl black, but the shower thing is black color. I got a few friends that did it, right? And then they say, right, it starts to peel and then the stains and all that, they have to wipe. They thought black harder to dirty.
No.
Turns out they need to clean more.
Yeah. So like the watermark is like
water stain.
Yeah.
So are there certain like design trends that you notice people like to follow or have been following, but what are the pros and cons?
Wabi Sabi, Japan.
Yes, I think let's focus more on, let's talk about Wabi Sabi.
Okay.
So,
is that your house?
Try not to feel attacked. No, it's like,
you say yours is Wabi Sabi, but.
No. So then I asked, because we did the video, right? Yeah. Then we needed to title it. So I faster asked my ID, like, hey, is it Wabi Sabi? Then he said, actually, it's like a bit mixed here and there. Yeah. So it's like a Japandi, Scandi, Wabi Sabi.
Just all the I's, all the B's. Yeah.
So I went to Google and search. The real definition of Wabi Sabi is to embrace imperfection, right? Raw, incomplete.
And unmoppable flaws.
Yep. So, you know, unfinished. But I don't think a lot of people will be able to accept all this kind of finishing on the wall. So for example, you say textured wall. You know, when it's very rough, everything, all the dust will trap there.
Yeah.
Oh.
Right. Then also, if you go, let's say go for raw, talk about cement, screed. Cement screed, it will crack over time.
Yeah.
Talk about lime wash to create that kind of effect. It's also very hard to upkeep because it cannot be touch up.
Which one of your wall is lime wash?
Two of my walls, my featured wall and my bedroom wall, but we did it ourselves.
Yeah.
So even if it looks imperfect, it's like we did something.
Wabi Sabi.
Well, exactly. It's supposed to be imperfect. Every time right, something goes like a bit wrong, right, I just tell like Ned, Wabi Sabi, imperfection.
Yeah. It's good that you can accept because a lot of homeowners out there, they can't accept the fact it's imperfect. They expect everything to be perfect.
So in Singapore, most people actually probably tend to mix a few styles, right?
Yeah. Yes. They like to mix and match. So sometimes we don't even know what theme is that. So
they show you the mood board, but it's like five different things going
rightfully,
on.
Rightfully, sometimes you know designer, we will design somehow or other along the way, the theme will go different way.
Which makes sense, I guess. Because like a lot of people don't know what they want. So they only know what they see and go, hey, I like. And then it's up to you to try and fit everything together.
Correct. And again, design is very subjective. I might like it, but you might not like it. So we always must find a midpoint with client.
Other than Wabi Sabi, what are some other trends that are currently?
Japandi.
It's a Japanese and Scandi together.
Yeah.
Oh. What's your least favorite interior design trend?
Scandinavian.
Oh, why?
Huh, IKEA. IKEA is Scandinavian.
Because
the company is, but
because I was in the era where Scandinavian was very popular. So I was there for maybe, Scandinavian was in trend for 7 to 8 years.
Ooh.
So why I dislike it, it's very boring. Correct.
Okay.
Is it because there's nothing much you can imprint on in terms of your own
You can't incorporate style? Much of the thing. So you just need to make it white, either white or wood. And the wood has to be specific. Cannot be those dark walnut color. It has to be a light wood color.
It's like a Muji wood.
Correct.
Another renovation mistake that is very avoidable is that people don't tend to take a close look at their home beforehand. Before renovation, when you get the keys, right, they say the ideal is if you are able to go with your ID to your empty house and actually do the measurements and plot things out instead of just relying on a floor plan.
To get a precise quotation, ID needs to go down to do a final measurement to make sure that everything is tally to the quotation to avoid any hidden costs, because you wouldn't want halfway through say, oh, I miss out this measurement, then I need to top up this, top up that. And nobody is going to like hidden costs, honestly.
Yeah, you ever before realize that you forgot to account for something and then you bopian need to do more work or like buy more material or whatever, and then decide because you didn't tell your client upfront, right? You makan the cost.
But for me, if let's say it's really because of my fault, then I will just wait it off with client because I wouldn't want to bring it up and homeowners not going to be happy about it.
Yeah,
they are not going to pay for it because it's my fault. So to solve this issue, it's okay to sacrifice a bit of a profit, just pay and just get it done.
Customer happiness first.
Correct.
Yeah. On the note of cost, so I mean something that people don't factor in is that usually your reno does end up being more than what you expected and works tend to delay. In for example, Alison work also delay. She's currently experiencing this. But so can I ask, how realistic is a 20K budget for reno in 2024?
Okay, first and foremost, you need to really see how big, what is the scale of the renovation.
Okay, 3 to 4 room flat.
How extensive?
Yeah, how extensive actually?
BTO, so is BTO, everything is blank.
I would say 50K, at least 50K.
50K is big.
What 50K, about resale?
Resale at least 60 to 70. Yeah. 50 provided there's no flooring, like den house comes so, without flooring.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the main part of the cost comes from the flooring and overlaying your toilet and carpentry. Also the carpentry, these three.
What is overlaying toilet?
To overlay a new tiles because a lot of homeowners, they might not like the original tiles from HDB.
Oh, okay.
Actually not bad. Like water, not bad.
Waterproofing.
You don't need to do waterproofing because it's already done by HDB.
It's just new style. So new you just style. Put like a overlay on top of it.
Because
mine was like, because mine is a resale.
You had to.
Every wall that can hit, I hit.
What
then
the
every heck? Floor, the whole floor, everything you see right is like, bam, like tear down to a bare minimum. So a bulk of my cost is the hacking part.
But actually hacking, right, faster than I thought it would be. Yeah.
It's damn fast.
Yeah.
Usually HDB only give us 3 days to hack.
Yeah.
What the heck?
Yeah. Then we'll take the 4th day to clear the rubbish.
So okay. So if people buy their BTO right with flooring, then how much?
I would say 20 to 30K should be sufficient.
Possible.
Possible.
But you have to opt in for the ugly. Okay lah, not ugly lah. Depending on your personal preference.
Don't get me wrong, you can spend 10 to 20K also possible. It depends on how extensive you want.
You want people to say, hey, nice reno, or oh, you move in.
But a realistic average is 50K for a BTO.
Without flooring?
40, 50.
40 after you ask for the discount.
I must say, okay, to be honest, the HDB stuff, right, is really not bad. It's just my own personal preference. I don't really like shiny tiles. And like, they always give you this beige, super shiny, you can see the reflection of your ceiling kind. Like, the toilets one are not bad because it's like grey.
Yeah.
So it's pretty cool.
Not the BTO, the door.
The like, main door or the toilet
door? The toilet door, it will like, bang, then you close.
Oh, yeah. The folding ones?
Yeah. I feel like a bit loud.
And I always feel like I need to explain to people how to lock it because they don't realize that you have to straighten it and then down. So like a lot of times people don't actually close. Yeah. I don't actually lock their toilet doors.
I'm just nodding along because I've not seen it.
I can show you.
But my house does use the PD door.
Do you recommend people to change their doors if they don't like their doors?
If let's say you have budget, then you can go and change it. If you want to save it, you can actually make good use of the door to to paint it over.
Oh.
Or spray paint over.
Or laminate?
Laminate, you can't do it on the toilet doors.
I see.
Yeah, you can paint it to save costs.
The next point talks about neglecting future-proofing. So I think just now, Roy keep asking like, oh, are you intending to have kids and all that, right? Because I think the interior design sense for when you are planning for a child versus when you are not is quite a big difference. And also like, are you expecting maybe your elderly parents to need to move in with you over the next 3 to 5 years?
Great point. Yeah.
Yeah, that's something that you could need to future-proof for also.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what are like certain things that I might need to look out for if I have dependents?
Okay. So I was in never a good position to advise my home client about the kid's safety. But now that I move in, having my own house with my kids, I can strongly say that the socket, it has to place higher. Because my kids can easily access.
Shit. My sockets are also low.
Yeah.
Wait, so you mean like it's dangerous for them because they were like...
You play. Keep playing.
Or like they on then they stick up.
I only realized this when I had my own house. Because the current house that I'm staying is higher. I'm staying with my in-law. It's higher lah.
They thought then, about it already.
Correct. Actually, in fact, it's the default one. But then the HDB comes with the BTO and it's quite low. Then I always advise homeowner, okay, I'll go with this side because it's standardized, so I need to standardize throughout the whole house. It's about 1.5 meter, which is quite low, which they can easily access. But then that's my regret. If I could redo everything, I'll make it higher so that they cannot reach. All right. Then for future proof, I think it can't be floor fan. So I install a ceiling fan. Not only I save space on the ground, but also to make the house more the room more windy. Mm,
I see.
Okay, then to install safety window grill.
Wait, why cannot be floor fan?
Because their hand might go in.
Oh, true. So it's thinking about with kids. Yeah. Okay. With kids. Ceiling fan makes more sense.
Or if you're elderly also.
Yeah. You never know
what happened.
Okay, so the safety grill is like what they call the invisible grill, but actually you can see one.
But then if you got Dyson, then you can like...
Okay, Dyson would be good, but because nowadays the house...
Not like, everybody can afford
the rooms. The rooms are very small, right? So we want to save space. So why not we take this chance to make use of the ceiling and install one ceiling fan?
Also right now that government giving you vouchers, climate vouchers, fan included, might as well buy it with your fan.
I love the climate vouchers.
Yeah.
It came out
after I bought every single thing.
Oh, no, but you still can use it.
It lasts for like 7 or 8 years, I think. Yeah. No, I think the Dyson are very dangerous because, right, you get your kids used to putting it like nothing, right? Then suddenly when you got a proper
blade, then
I will put my head there. I think I'm that kind of child. I'll just go like, can my head fit, you know?
The Dyson one also got the power plug to the socket, also very dangerous.
Oh.
So we try to cut down the wires on the floor, on the ground.
Oh yeah, the amount of wires.
I can relate. As a new parent, right, suddenly you're just paranoid about everything. Everything. Like, do you think about, you know how they always say like childproofing, so yeah, your furniture can't have sharp edges. Are you concerned about those things as well?
Yes. So we try to have everything rounded. Or if not, you can go IKEA and buy those corner.
But this is why actually, right, the design aspect of everything being rounded is now fitting with practicality because it's childproof.
What a happy coincidence.
Wabi Sabi. It's not really Wabi Sabi.
You just wanted to throw it in. How about for elderly parents? Are there certain things that I need to look out for?
I think for them, try not to have too many things in the room.
So it's easier for them to move around.
One thing I heard also about for elderly parents, especially if they are like wheelchair bound, right, is to make sure that there are like ramps. So like the house, the front door, there's a ramp. Mm. Then maybe not too many curbs, toilets and stuff like that.
Mm.
So these are all the design that we need to take into consideration. Make sure that everything is flat, it's easy to move around.
Something that I saw also was if you have a smaller house, say maybe like 3 room, but maybe once in a while your parents come and like visit you or want to stay with you for a few nights, then it's important to consider like a modular option so that you can transform like a space in your living room to be like a temporary guest room, that kind. Yeah. For parents who visit once in a while, that kind.
Yeah, you can do that, lor.
Okay, so the last point on this article that is on Canvas naturally is hiring an interior designer who isn't the right fit. So I think a lot of people realize that what they, like, I mean, I look at portfolios and all that online, but then the interior designer that I go with doesn't always end up being the right interior designer for me.
Mm.
So then this brings me to the next segment. How do I find a good ID that is the right fit for me?
Shall I go through my pro? So I met like five or six different IDs. Three of them we met during an ID fair. It was different company, but I think our experience wasn't so great because I think it was quite rushed. We went there with our like floor plans ready, right? And it felt like the IDs just want to like close us as like a deal.
Yeah.
Cause they straight away go like, oh, okay, you want this? Okay, next step is we'll send you quotation. Then you like, you sign. You know, it's like, it was always about signing the quotation. Nothing to do with the design, about what we wanted. Then the other two that we met actually were very close. We liked them because we saw them on social media. So like one of them was through a YouTube video. The other one that we actually went with, we went through a lot of Instagram profiles. And then there was one where literally every home that they had, right, was exactly the style that we wanted. Mm. The only difference was that the first one again was a little bit more towards like, okay, so here's a quotation. Like every follow up on WhatsApp was like, do you want to sign? Do you want to sign? Do you want to sign? Mm. Whereas the ID that we actually ended up going for, the first meeting already, was they prepared a mood board. Even before we met them, they prepared a mood board for us already. The next step from there was 3D render. So unlike like having huge down payments, right, with them was everything you pay piecemeal. So before every part of the process, you just pay for that element. So 3D renders, you just pay for 3D render. Mm. Then when it's hacking, you just pay for hacking. So at any time you want to like chow, right, or like go like, okay, you're not for us, they were happy to just say it's fine.
Oh,
so
it was meant for like customer protection in that sense.
So how many transactions you actually made?
I think like 6 or 7.
Okay.
So like it was not like 10%, 30% or anything like that. It was okay, now hacking gonna start, pay for hacking. Now it's gonna be carpentry, and then you just pay for carpentry.
Interesting.
Yeah, so we thought that was quite friendly, lah. But it was more the fact that they came in with mood board. It was more of the design first rather than sign or quotation.
Like, is it a common thing that like ID just, how to say, or like what is the thinking behind pushing the client to be signing the quotation, you know what I mean?
Okay, in the market, there are two kinds of ID. First is just they are purely doing sales, which they just want to close you. And yeah, so they will use the tactic whereby they will just close you on the spot to without you thinking. They will give you a lot of offers. If you sign today, they will give you discount, huge offer. Give you this, give you that, but nothing is free. The other ID will be taking the extra effort to showcase what they can offer to their client, right? To do their mood board, to come up with 3D planning and what their style of coordinating a project.
How did you find your ID?
Oh, my ID is actually my friend. Before I engaged him, right, he actually did his house. So I actually go to his house like every month, like to hang with them. So I like actually see his work and like I'm like living his work.
So it's a life case study.
Yeah, and so how I know they are very trustable is that their personality, right, is like very decisive. And if there's a problem, right, they cannot go to sleep if they don't solve it.
Oh.
Which I think is like a damn good trait of a ID because like things will pop up and I feel like you need that kind of assurance because I am like a damn like indecisive person and I need someone who has that kind of like direction, right? Then I like see whether I want or not, that kind of thing. Yeah, so I know that they are very trustable, plus they always come to my house also. And then like when we have the discussion, like you said, right, like we actually discuss at the dining table and then every time there's like something, right, we can just walk to the room and like measure and whatnot. So I'm very comfortable with them lah. And I feel like one thing I appreciate about my ID is that they are as excited as me to do my house. Yeah, then I feel like it's a very collaborative teamwork.
Yeah.
Because I do have other ID friends and although their design really very nice, but then it's kind of like the higher end one. And then like they might suggest things I'm not very comfortable like budget wise. Like I know their style is like a higher end client, that kind of thing. So I think one important thing is to see whether you can vibe with your ID in terms of the same design goals.
You know, it's not easy to do a friend's house because very often
it's stressful.
Really. So it's not easy. So you and your friends still okay?
Still okay.
That's good.
It's because I think like we quite say it as it is, that kind of thing.
I've seen a lot of cases whereby designer and their friends, they
no longer friends.
My mom and her friend that recommended her this friend is no longer friends. Are there any other things that you think that clients would benefit from to ask before deciding which ID to sign with? So one example that I've heard of is my friends say, right, you should ask how many projects is your ID currently handling.
Yeah. Actually got one question, right? Homeowner must ask where the ID stay. But you don't shoot. Because if let's say your house is at Sengkang, but the ID stay at Jurong, the ID will never go down to Sengkang every day one because too far already. But this one no.
Yeah.
It's very important to ask the ID where they stay.
It makes a lot of sense because like I think John was mentioning like his ID right literally lives right next to their condo, right? So she was literally there every day. Got any problem, right? She's there in 5 minutes. So like obviously it's never going to be that close, but if it's in the general vicinity, like at least got any problem, that you know they will go down.
Yeah. Then the other one will be you have to ask your ID to bring you down to your existing site to take a look.
As in their current projects?
Current projects.
Because, I can do that?
Yep.
Wow.
To take a look at the workmanship. Then how everything turns out from the 3D to real life. See whether is it realistic or not.
Where do you get most of your clients from? As in, do they come to you through word of mouth or is it?
It's through referral, Canvas. If not, will be our own website. The clientele from Canvas honestly is a lot more genuine.
They are ready to move on to the next step of their renovation. Is that
yes,
what you mean?
Yes, okay. Because why they get hold of Homeowners in particular, they will not mass send. They will just send to five different ID firms.
like curate like correct. Created personalized, yep. Right?
Okay, to 5 different ID firm. Mm. Whereas some other platform, they do send up to 15 ID firms.
Oh. Right.
Okay.
But it also feels like the quality, the least, because they came in and curated, there's a better match in some ways.
Yes, there's a better match also because the IDs that even get to be on Qanvast are like, they go through quite a rigorous vetting process.
Mm.
Yeah.
Plus also I think like the biggest fear amongst customers now is that my ID might just like run away or chow. Like I like don't know the due diligence, but this one Qanvast already does the due diligence. Like make sure that it's like, legit firms.
And Qanvast has a guarantee. So it's called a 50K, up to 50K Qanvast guarantee. So if halfway through something happened, right, your ID run away or whatever, they will pay you back.
Wow. Oh.
Up to 50K. Yeah.
Okay, okay.
And they also have this thing that Roy's company is on, if I'm not wrong, that is called the Qanvast Super Trust List. Mm. So it's essentially trusted ID firms.
Hey, wow, super trusted. Hey.
Everybody can be on it.
So there are total about, I think, 300 firm, ID firm on board with Qanvast, but only the top 20% of the ID can get the super trust.
Wow. So,
is it true that IDs charge more when you find them via Qanvast?
It's not true at all.
Oh, so whatever cost doesn't get passed on.
It doesn't get passed on. In fact, there are some other platform out there. Yes, we do need to mark up slightly higher just to cover the fee.
Slightly higher is like example, if it's like a 60K Reno.
Maybe ranging from 1% to 5%.
So the platform actually charges you 1-3% or whatever.
Yes. In fact, we need to make it higher, charge it higher so that we can pay that referral fee.
But you don't pay a referral fee on Qanvast.
No, we don't do that. I'd rather they go through Qanvast, right?
Alright.
But we couldn't put any of
that. And now it's time for painting of the episode. Alison, please help me bring down today's painting. And meanwhile, let me share a bit about how the Daily Ketchup is proud to be supporting Shaping Hearts. Shaping Hearts is an inclusive art festival selling art pieces made by persons with disabilities. So this piece right here is called...
So this piece is called Roots by Alex Lim. So he's a person with autism who has explored art since a young age as a means to calm his mind.
Okay, if I didn't tell you what this painting is about, right, how would you interpret it?
I would say it's like flora and fauna
and big words.
Lively forest.
Yeah, so Alex shared a bit about his painting with us, and essentially he's talking about how Roots actually depicts a painting of the forest with hidden opportunities. So you see like small ladybugs here and ants and all that, and it adds to the liveliness of the whole painting. So I mean, since we're talking about interior design, if you would like to have a meaningful piece of art in your home, Alex's work here is a great example, and you will also be able to see art pieces from many other local artists with disabilities at Shaping Hearts this 19th of October, and we will see you at our Tampines Hub for that. Okay, so we've come to the end of today's episode. Thank you for watching, and of course a big thank you to Roy for joining us and answering all our random questions. Woo! And once again, a big thank you to our partners for today's episode, Qanvast. So Qanvast is ideal for new homeowners who don't know where to start or are too busy. So they have a free ID matching service that you can just go. It takes a few minutes only to fill up the form, and then they will get you a curated list of designers according to your preferences, and there's no obligation at all. So we'll put a link down here as well as in the description box down below. Do check them out. You can also follow them on their socials. We'll see you in the next episode. Bye bye.
Ciao.
Bye.
My car, what do you call the guy that sells your car or help you buy car?
Car dealer.
He wear his shirt got like whole one. But it's like all branded.
Or Balenciaga, I think.
yeah, that one purposely got whole one.
No, it's like he wears so many times until like gives a bit of like,
that could be his lucky sales shirt. It could be that one day, right, in 1990, right, he probably sold his like best car, he wore that shirt, and to him that's his lucky shirt, so he wears it every single time.
Okay, I just saw it as a power play.
Could be, or he really needs his job.